This is A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. On today's show, we'll have the Green Report starting off the hour. And then I'll be speaking with Gary Hughes of Biofuel Watch about Chile's reset and how that will affect environmental justice in the country. And then we'll switch gears just a bit and speak to the Oakland Institute's Executive Director on the Mount Mithil once again. But first, the news.
I'm Eileen Alfandary with KPFA News Headlines. U.S. coronavirus cases have hit a staggering new high, more than 153,000 confirmed cases in a single day, according to statistics compiled by Johns Hopkins University. A record 67,000 people were in the hospital with COVID-19. The U.S. has recorded more than 10.5 million cases since the pandemic began. More than 242,000 people in this country have died. A University of Washington institute that the Trump administration relies on projects the nation will hit more than 320,000 deaths by January 1st and 439,000 by March 1st if mask use and other measures in response to the pandemic remain the same. The Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation says about two-thirds of the population wear masks. The Institute said universal mask wearing would cut death by 30% and save 68,000 lives by March 1st. State and local officials around the country are scrambling as they try to cope with their mounting COVID-19 caseloads. While President Trump and Vice President Mike Pence remain silent on the catastrophe, state officials are urging their residents to step up mask wearing and social distancing. In New York, Governor Andrew Cuomo issued an order starting today for bars, restaurants, and gyms to close by 10 p.m. He set a cap of 10 people for private gatherings. In Illinois, public health officials asked employers to allow their workers to work from home when possible and urged residents to stay at home as much as possible and skip non-essential travel. Dr. Angela Dunn is the state epidemiologist for the Utah Department of Health.
The capacity of our referral hospitals and their ICU beds is at 87.5%. We know that COVID continues to spread throughout the state, throughout all of our communities and all of our age groups. It's not one particular population that is experiencing the spread. And I will tell you that our only hope for slowing the spread of COVID and protecting our hospitals is if each one of us is wearing masks way more than we're doing it now.
Earlier this week, Utah's Republican governor ordered state residents to wear masks and not gather with anyone outside their immediate household. A coalition of federal and state officials says the November 3rd election was the most secure in U.S. history. The statement from the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency says in bold type, there is no evidence that any voting system deleted or lost votes, changed votes, or was in any way compromised. The statement is a direct contradiction of President Trump's false claims of ballot fraud. Trump's latest lie on Twitter is that the Dominion electronic voting system deleted 2.7 million votes from him nationwide, including nearly 250,000 in Pennsylvania. Nate Snyder is a former Department of Homeland Security official under the Obama administration, now teaching at the University of Chicago. He spoke to Al Jazeera.
One of the major contributors for making this the most secure election in U.S. history is the fact there were large numbers with vote by mail and actual having physical paper ballots.
Last night's statement by the federal, state, and industry officials who coordinate election cybersecurity did not directly mention Trump or his claims of fraud, but the implication was clear. The statement said, while there are many unfounded claims and opportunities for misinformation about the process of the elections, quote, we can assure you we have the utmost confidence in the security and integrity of our elections, and you should too. The statement was distributed by the agency, which spearheaded federal election protection efforts, and tweeted by its director, Chris Krebs. Hours earlier, he was the subject of a media report that said he had told associates he expected to be fired by President Trump. Former President Obama is faulting Republicans who have gone along with President Trump's refusal to acknowledge he lost his reelection bid Obama spoke to CBS 60 Minutes about Trump's baseless claims of voter fraud.
They appear to be motivated in part because the president doesn't like to lose and never admits loss. I'm more troubled by the fact that other Republican officials who clearly know better are going along with this, are humoring him in this fashion. It is one more step in delegitimizing not just the incoming Biden administration, but democracy generally. And that's a dangerous path.
70% of Republicans polled in a recent survey said they did not believe the election was free and fair. Arizona has now been called for Joe Biden by a number of additional media organizations, joining those which put the formerly red state in Biden's column on election night. Biden's lead is 11,000 votes, fewer than on election night, but not enough to trigger a mandatory recount. Arizona has 11 electoral votes. The current tally is Biden at 290 electoral votes, President Trump at 217 after Alaska was added to his column. Arizona has not voted for a Democratic presidential candidate since 1996. Latino organizers turned out the vote. The Arizona Republic reports that nearly 73% of Latino voters in key Latino-majority precincts in Arizona chose Biden over Trump. A coalition of Latino groups said in those precincts, Latino voter turnout rose by as much as 20 percentage points compared with 4 years ago. Climate justice groups are pressing California state officials to adopt a statewide ban on the use of natural gas in new construction to fight greenhouse gas emissions. Suzanne Potter reports.
Climate advocates are pressing the California Energy Commission to ban natural gas in new construction starting in 2022. The CEC updates building codes every 3 years. In December, the agency is expected to consider a less aggressive plan to offer developers pollution credits as an incentive to go all electric. Johnny Kosher with the Rocky Mountain Institute says allowing new gas-powered buildings would be counterproductive.
All electric is cheaper. It's better for the climate. It'll reduce emissions by 3 million tons by 2030 if we do it now rather than waiting to 2025. So we can't wait. We should just do it immediately.
39 California cities already have passed so-called REACH codes that limit natural gas in new construction. For Public News Service, I'm Suzanne Potter.
Weather forecast for the San Francisco Bay Area: showers beginning late morning or afternoon, breezy afternoon in Fresno and the central San Joaquin Valley, mostly sunny skies. I'm Eileen Alfandari, more news at 94.1. Headlines at noon. Join us at 6 for the Pacifica Evening News. We are back. This is A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. Good morning to you all. We're going to go ahead and start the hour off with the Green Report, which is aired on our sister station, KPFK in Los Angeles. Take a listen.
One of the many merits of the excellent conversation I had yesterday with President-elect Joe Biden was that we were strongly agreed on the need to work together in the fight against climate change.
President-elect Joe Biden begins rebuilding U.S. climate policy at home and abroad. Federal Reserve warns climate change threatens to destabilize the financial system. Renewable energy industry defies COVID, gets set for record growth. Plus, Trump White House racing the red light to roll back environmental standards and wreck federal science on the way out the door.
That assumes they're going out the door. All of those stories and more straight ahead from BradBlog.com. I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
Stand by for 6 minutes of independent green news, politics, analysis, and snarky comment.
For all those of you who voted for President Trump, I understand the disappointment tonight. I've lost a couple times myself.
Wait a second. Why isn't he talking about shower pressure and how windmills give you cancer? That's so unpresidential.
Yes, this is your Green News Report. Okay, Desi Doyen, did we ever figure out how many letters into the Greek alphabet we are now with hurricane or tropical storm or whatever called Eta?
Yes, that is seventh in the Greek alphabet.
So if it hits Florida twice, does that also make it the eighth letter at the same time?
No, it does not. But Tropical Storm Eta is hitting Florida a second time, even as the state is still struggling with heavy flooding from its first round of torrential rains just a few days ago. The National Hurricane Center says a record 30th named storm is likely to form in coming days. And yes, climate scientists warn that man-made global warming is changing hurricanes, with very warm ocean temperatures contributing to this year's record high hyperactive hurricane season.
So Eta is the seventh letter. Theta, is that still out and about, that storm?
Yes.
And then there's a ninth one brewing as well?
Yes.
Oh boy.
That would be Iota, pronounced Yoda.
Well, you don't have to show off.
In other news, the Trump administration is racing the red light, accelerating efforts to deregulate in its waning days with a flood of last-minute energy rollbacks, permitting decisions, and new rules to allow more toxic water pollution from power plants, weaken appliance energy efficiency standards, and scale back mine safety oversight.
Of course they are.
The Trump White House also fired the agency head that oversees regulation of electricity and natural gas, and removed the scientist in charge of the National Climate Assessment, the authoritative government-wide report on climate change, and they're going to install a climate science denier in his place.
How much damage can he do in about 70 days?
A lot, if they can't get rid of him.
Why couldn't they get rid of him?
Because Trump has moved to change civil service rules so that his moles will be harder to remove.
We'll see about that.
The Washington Post reports that the incoming Biden administration plans an all-of-government approach to incorporate climate action into domestic, economic, and foreign policy, using executive branch authority to restructure parts of the federal government to move faster on global warming in every federal agency and department, even ones not typically associated with the environment, like the Treasury Department through trade policy, and the Agriculture Department paying farmers to store carbon in their soils. Structural changes that don't require congressional action.
That's very cool.
Biden also began rebuilding relationships with U.S. allies this week and talking climate in calls with foreign heads of state. U.K. Prime Minister Boris Johnson sounded downright elated about renewed U.S. leadership on climate change in advance of next year's COP26 U.N. climate summit.
The incoming Biden-Harris administration is able to make common cause with us. In particular, it was extremely exciting to talk to President-elect Biden about what he wants to do with the COP26 summit next year, Mr. Speaker, in which, as you know, the UK is leading the world in driving down carbon emissions and tackling climate change.
That is great. And by the way, Boris Johnson also called Donald Trump the previous president in one of his remarks.
Even the U.S. Central Bank, the Federal Reserve, has finally formally acknowledged that failure to act swiftly on climate change threatens to destabilize the global financial system with abrupt changes in asset values. And while the oil industry is struggling because of the coronavirus pandemic crushing demand for oil, renewable energy is defying COVID. That's according to the notoriously cautious International Energy Agency in its annual report report this week announcing that renewable energy hit record growth in 2020, and the IEA projects that by 2025, renewables will become the largest source of electricity generation in the world, ending coal's 5 decades as the top power source. The IEA projects that by 2025, renewables will supply 1/3 of the world's electricity, a remarkably rapid shift that also will substantially reduce air pollution.
I told you months and months ago, maybe even years ago, sell your oil and coal stocks, buy renewable energy. Just saying. For much more on all of these stories and the ones we couldn't get to today, check out our website at greennews.bradblog.com. Find, follow, and share us planet-wide on the Facebooks and the Twitters at Green News Report. I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
And this has been your Green News Report.
We are back. We're going to switch gears and speak to Gary Hughes of Biofuel Watch on the political reset in Chile and what it means for the environment. Will Chilean companies like Arauco and CMPC then engage in systematic deforestation to create paper products, and at the same time, who seem to be making strides to meet climate issues halfway, be restricted further? With the urban population doubling in the last 30 years, they are facing more pollution with their water and air. Here's Gary Hughes from Biofuel Watch. Global Justice Ecology Project and Biofuel Watch congratulate the peoples of Chile. Overwhelming majority votes to throw out Pinochet-era constitution 1 year after People's Uprising demands real change. And that is from the press release put out by Global Justice Ecology Project in conjunction with Biofuel Watch. They're recognizing the historic achievements of their partners in Chile and are inspired by the work on the ground in Chile to document and support the people's uprising there. And I want to talk about the global environmental impacts of throwing out these Pinochet-era type constitutions and edicts. And here to talk about that is Gary Hughes. Now, Gary Hughes is with Biofuel Watch. Mr. Hughes, this is your first time on A Rude Awakening. Tell us what you do for Biofuel Watch first.
Well, thank you so much for having me on the air, Sabrina. My work with Biofuel Watch is pretty diverse. I have a pretty big portfolio of forest and climate matters here in California. So really, I'm a redwoods forest defender from way back. And then I also have a portfolio of work in Chile, supporting partners in Chile. And there's a, you know, a lot of really important connections between California and Chile that I think KPFA listeners would be really excited to learn about, that are really at the heart of a lot of the work that I do.
All right. So you're definitely qualified. No doubt about that. Now, there's been a lot of growing demands and actions by the Mapuche people. They're demanding the return of their traditional territories. They're demanding the return of their land. So what does that mean environmentally speaking, as far as kicking out all of these Pinochet-era type laws, discriminatory laws, laws that have been allowing these transnational corporations to grab land in Chile? What does that mean for the Mapuche people?
Well, I think for folks who are listening here in California and are thinking about how what's happening in Chile might relate to them, is to recognize that, you know, huge expanses of southern Chile have become essentially industrial sacrifice zones. Forest plantations, they might be referred to, but forest is very diverse and, you know, endemic ecosystem. In Chile, they have suffered a substitution of the native ecosystems with these exotic tree species monoculture plantations. And for folks in California, you know, to imagine Chile is basically a geographic mirror of California. So if you wanted to imagine, for instance, what the Mapuche people are confronting in terms of dispossession, imagine then if instead of native forests along the coast of California, from the Big Sur up to the Oregon border and beyond, there were simply millions and millions and millions of acres of eucalypt and other, you know, monoculture species, which we already have in some instances. But these issues of dispossession, of usurpation, and of loss of ancestral lands are really very directly connected to this industrial forestry model, which California residents, with people listening to KPFA, should know was exported by industry interests here in California to Chile in the 1960s and the 1970s. So these are really age-old, what is injustices is the word I'm looking for, now that the Mapuche people are working to address, and what is happening on the ground is really very closely connected to the history of economic intervention from California in Chile.
Mm-hmm. Most definitely. And now you are quoted, let's see here, in the... Yes, in the press release, you're quoted as saying that what your partners are saying is that the opportunity to pursue a new constitution in Chile is simply the opening of a door that has been opened by a spontaneous, organic, and leaderless uprising that was reinforced in the moment by the experience of decades of political organizing in the face of daunting repression. Now, as far as that new constitution is concerned, how are the environmental demands going to be placed on the new government? Is there any type of plan to incorporate more environmental rights and more environmental equanimity for the Mapuche people and the millions and millions of acres that you're speaking of now?
Yes, there's definitely a vision for how to secure deeper change through this process that would lead, hopefully, to the approval of a new constitution in Chile. You know, it's important to recognize when we speak about the uprising that it started a year ago in Chile. There was a rebellion, as it were, against an economic model that simply resulting in these sacrifice zones that I was speaking of, and really severe economic inequality. This process to pursue a new constitution was really something of an effort at the elite and the political classes in Chile to try to find a political solution to this rebellion. And it resulted then in late October, finally, in a plebiscite vote by the Chilean people where they decided whether or not they were going to pursue a new constitution. And nearly 80% of the voters in Chile who participated in this plebiscite said, yes, we are going to pursue a new constitution, and we're going to toss the constitution of the Pinochet dictatorship into the trash bin. So this idea, though, of protecting nature, of actually, perhaps even going so far as enshrining the rights of nature in the Constitution, this is central to the efforts of people who have been organizing for this kind of change in Chile for a long time. The indigenous people themselves are both somewhat skeptical of this process. And then there's also a large number of Mapuche organizations and community bodies that have taken a good look at the opportunity that is present here. And this is why, as well, there's an effort to ensure that there's reserved seats for indigenous people in this new process for developing a constitution. So, I think what KPFA listeners should really think about at this point in time when we talk about climate action is that the vision for decolonization is central to what's happening in Chile. And this is something that climate justice movements around the world could be looking at. So addressing old issues of land dispossession, the cultural impacts that come with that, these are central to this process around developing a new constitution in Chile.
And there are these, and this was our last question here. Now, there are these, just to drill down a little bit more, these major multinational corporations, transnational corporations like Arauco and CMPC, and they are all about the industrial timber plantations. And are they going to be kicked out, or is there a process to remove them? How is that supposed to work as far as getting these?
Those are really good questions. How is that supposed to work? How are we going to support our indigenous partners in holding these interests accountable? And this is where I think California residents and KPFA listeners should be really attentive to what's going on here in the United States and globally around climate politics. And in particular, I want to draw everyone's attention to the sort of excitement that people have about the Biden administration taking the United States back into the Paris Accord to re-engage again with the United Nations processes around climate change. Everyone should really be very, very concerned about what's going on at the United Nations around climate change. And in particular, take a look at what happened with COP25. The last climate change meetings were supposed to happen in Santiago de Chile, but because of the global interest of the United Nations and companies like Arauco and CMPC to hide from the world the human rights violations that were occurring in Chile with the repression of the social uprising, the United Nations and many other players in this were happy to move the climate meetings to Madrid. And they did so, wringing their hands, concerned, oh my gosh, we can't have these meetings in Chile. And then what happened then a year later is you find out that in Chile, they voted to pursue a new constitution, showing that the uprising in Chile was an authentic, organic expression of the desire of the Chilean people for climate justice. So when it comes to securing these changes, I hope people who are listening to KPFA know that we need to hold companies like Arauco responsible, but we also need to make sure that processes such as what is happening at the United Nations are not just being built out to greenwash and protect interests like Arauco. And here in California, it's interests like Chevron, it's Green Diamond Resources Company, it's Sierra Pacific Industries. What we need to do to learn from what's happening in Chile is understand that so much climate policy that is being pushed right now is really meant to protect polluting interest in polluting industry and not to protect people and the planet.
All right. I couldn't have said it better myself. Gary Hughes of Biofuel Watch. And we all need to be watching what's happening in Chile very, very, very closely, more closely than we have in the past, because this is a pivotal point. It's a pivotal time where, things could go sideways. So we've all got to watch and keep an eye out on what's happening there. And Gary Hughes, we'll definitely have you back on the line to talk about this further, because I know Biofuel Watch will be watching, right?
Yes, Sabrina, thank you so much for having me on. And this really is a very critical time, because we're pivoting right now in the United States and globally from this hardcore climate science denial of Trump to the softcore climate science denial of the neoliberal Democrats and their markets-based solutions, which we have seen here in California, and we've seen how they failed. And so we need to be very vigilant, and we need to stand up now and be forceful and celebrate the deposition of Trump here. But we need to stand up and hold Biden accountable before they continue forward with a climate, vision that is really only meant to protect extractive industry.
Absolutely. Gary Hughes, thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening. We will definitely be speaking with you again in the very near future, because we've all got to stay abreast of what's happening. Truly appreciate you taking the time. Thank you.
Always available. Thank you, Sabrina. Second, thank you, KPFA. Everybody scatters and hopes it goes away. Ah!
going to switch gears one more time, folks, and I need to preface this next segment with this statement. After last Friday's show, I received an email from several folks from the Task Force for the Americas refuting the claims made by the Oakland Institute's research and findings from their report entitled Nicaragua's Failed Revolution. There were no facts or proof included in the email to back up their claims against the Oakland Institute, and let it be known they have been known to attack any entity that speaks ill of the Daniel Ortega regime. And this is my rebuttal to them. This is a climate emergency show. With that, it is necessary to have those conversations around environmental justice, which includes the theft of land by transnational corporations and the environmental impacts thereof, which is the purview of organizations like the Oakland Institute. I have found their frontline reporting on global land grabs to be impeccable in its scope, irrefutable in their cogent delivery. For years, they have been a go-to source for anyone seeking the truth about worldwide thievery by multinational corporations in conjunction with local governments in countries all over the world. Also, I found it quite disturbing that anyone could refute the environmental impacts of land grabbing and turn it into a political issue that has nothing to do with the issues that were on the table for a discussion. In my humble opinion, it is akin to denying the racial aspects of the climate emergency that the indigenous and Afro-descendant people are exclusively on the front lines and are forced to deal with as far as the murders and disappearances of their people head on, as is the case of Nicaragua. So, with that, I found it necessary to have the Oakland Institute's executive director, Honorata Mittal, back on the show for a rebuttal. But before I air that interview with Ms. Mittal, it is necessary to make it very clear to you that these attacks, these specious claims, do not have and have not been limited to just the Oakland Institute. They have refuted the investigative reporting of Nathan Halverson of Reveal and PBS NewsHour, as well as others. Mr. Halverson in particular was also in receipt of a letter refuting the claims he made in his investigative report entitled Conflict Beef from Nicaragua Feeds U.S. Market Amid Pandemic. The article appeared in Reveal from the Center for Investigative Reporting on October 21st, 2020. If anyone knows who Nate Halverson is, you'll know he's an Emmy Award-winning producer. In the article, he clearly states that due to the pandemic, Nicaraguan cattle ranchers, spurred by a surge in beef exports to the United States and desperate for more pastured land to keep up with the demand, are attacking indigenous communities in the forests of eastern Nicaragua, forcing residents to flee and killing those who resist. Dozens have been left dead. Once in possession of their stolen forest land, the cattle ranchers burn it, destroying pristine jungle that contributes to the destruction of the second largest rainforest in the Americas. End quote. Again, that's from Nathan Halverson of Reveal, Center for Investigative Reporting, his latest for RevealNews.org, Conflict Beef from Nicaragua Feeds U.S. Market Amid Pandemic. Enough said. Now here's the rebuttal interview with the Oakland Institute's Executive Director, Honorata Mittal.
Thanks, Sabrina, for the opportunity to respond to the allegations that have been made against the Institute. But before we start, I would just say, as we have told them, the critics of our work in Nicaragua, that at the Oakland Institute is an independent think tank. We do not accept any corporate or any government funding. We are provided predominantly general support by individual donors and family foundations. But more important, what we are known for around the world that has made us a go-to place for communities who are impacted by so-called development projects, whether it is Papua New Guinea or Sri Lanka or Ethiopia or Tanzania or Kenya, or in this case, Nicaragua, our work really starts when we are asked for assistance by the impacted communities themselves. We are known for rigorous research. People might not like what we say, but they can't poke a hole through it. And this is a similar situation with those who are troubled by the findings of our research and field research in Nicaragua. First of all, I would want the listeners to know that they are not biased writers who have written that report. I myself conducted field research, and that field research started after we were contacted by the mosquito communities in the North Caribbean coast of Nicaragua, which is autonomous. We initially started with very intense desk research, and the findings were so problematic that we realized that we needed to actually verify the truth by doing field research. So it was I myself who traveled downriver Rio Coco, visiting the communities and hearing and experiencing firsthand the fear, the threats, the violence that the communities have faced from colonos and the drivers of this violence, which are cattle ranching, gold mining, and so-called forestry plantation projects. This has resulted in people being displaced, homes being burnt, and not just that. Many deaths have occurred. People have disappeared, never to be seen again. I spoke to fathers who have lost their sons in this violence. I spoke to a wife whose husband was taken away, and 3 years later, she was still waiting for him to return. The children are waiting for their father to return. So this is not any made-up stuff, but this was first-hand testimony that our report elevated. Secondly, a lot of the data that we have presented in the report actually comes from the government itself. So, for instance, last Friday when you interviewed me, Sabrina, you were looking at the research we had just put out, which shows that how the gold mining corporations are behind this, one of the drivers of this violence against the indigenous and Afro-descendant communities. Now, I didn't make this fact up, but it is pro-Nicaragua, the investment agency of Nicaragua, which is claiming that 60% of the country's territory is available for mining. And the videos of companies from Caliber to Condor to BT Gold, they're available on the company websites where they're boasting to their investors how many millions and billions of dollars they will make. And in one instance, they talk about the land they have managed to secure, how it is the best government to work with, and what they give back to communities in one absolutely disgraceful video. When they talked about millions of dollars they make, they talk about what they've given to communities are like 30-some latrines. There is no process of consultation. There is no process of recognition of national legislation. So for those who are troubled by our findings, I would urge them. I understand that many of us are wary of U.S. imperialist policies, U.S. intervention, especially in Latin American countries. But for us to turn into an ostrich with a head stuck in the sand and not seeing that this revolution, which was supposed to bring prosperity and equity for the people of Nicaragua, has turned into another regime, which is, you know, in cahoots with multinational corporations, giving up the lands, destruction of environment. They're only fooling themselves.
Wow. Okay. And moving on with the rest of this letter, they're claiming that there's another element to this story. They're drilling down on, and that's the task force for the Americas. Again, folks, this is a letter that I received after the airing of my interview with Ms. Honorable Mitchell. She is the executive director of the Oakland Institute. This was referencing their report, the recent report that they released entitled Nicaragua's Failed Revolution. And they're basically stating and refuting all of the research and the findings from that report. And to drill down more, they're saying that the Oakland Institute has hidden the funding that has been received for their anti-Nicaragua project and story. Now, what I'm not understanding is how is this anti-Nicaragua when this is about the indigenous people, when this is about the Afro-descendant people of that country? I mean, you can't get any more of that country or of any country than their indigenous people to begin with. So can you drill down a little bit more? They're saying that that you received money from the Howard G. Buffett Foundation, who is the son of billionaire investor Warren Buffett, and that because you received this money, you're doing this so-called anti-Nicaragua reporting.
Thanks, Sabrina. Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, as I mentioned, our work on Nicaragua and especially land rights of the indigenous and Afro-descendant communities started at the request of the communities. We use general support funding from several funders, and their names are available on our 990 forms, which include some of the most progressive family foundations. The only foundation which actually earmarked it because of transparency is actually the Buffett Foundation. And I also have pointed out to these critics, if you look at our publications and you look at our report, Misinvestment in Agriculture, which called out clearly the implications of land grabbing, which are happening around the world. The foreword was done by Howard Buffett himself. So if we had anything to hide, we would not make these things publicly available. The issue, again, is if you look at the discourse around Nicaragua in recent years, even the congressional or subcommittee hearings, or you look at the sanctions imposed, they have to do with the very violent crackdown of popular protest in 2018. Nobody talks about the violence and the plight of the indigenous and Afro-descendant communities, and that has gone on for decades. That has gone on for decades, and nobody's talked about it. So our report shattered the silence, because Nicaragua is seen as a country which recognized through its national legislation autonomy of the indigenous lands. It recognized through different laws that they have to do land titling, demarcation, and saneamiento, which means clear the lands of corporations and individuals who do not have the consent of the communities to be in their lands. The government has never done that. And our report also says it is not just the Ortega administration. If you look at the successive right-wing governments that came after Ortega, after the first time round, they all were into privatization. They were all into opening up these lands to colonos, to mining and other corporations. What we do point out is that it is the second time round when the Ortega administration has been there that the violence against the indigenous has really escalated. And it has escalated not just because impunity is afforded to corporations, to the colonos, but also we clearly demonstrate in our reports that the complicity of the government. Now, these are facts that are not made up. We have provided, made available all the documentation. We have looked at the government sources. We contacted the government ministries before the release of the report to hear their perspective. We've done everything. So for this task force of the Americas and a handful of individuals who have showed up, they are more keen to suppress people having access to information and a country fulfilling its obligations. I would think that they, if they really cared about Nicaragua, if they really cared about the people of Nicaragua, including the indigenous and Afro-descendant communities, given their close connections to the Ortega government, they would be working to make things better. If they make things better, that is what we're interested in. We are interested in supporting the demand for saneamiento. We are not interested in regime change. We are not interested in anything. At the Institute, we speak up against any government, whether it's Tanzania, whether it's Ethiopia, whether it's India, or whether it's the United States itself. And our work is determined by internationally recognized conventions and treaties and human rights. And for those critics who are challenging our funding, who are challenging our remarkable record over the years of working in partnership with communities, I think they're really doing a disservice to themselves and to the people of Nicaragua.
No doubt. I have to agree with you there. Now this is an open letter. Again, it's from the task force, a group calling themselves the Task Force on the Americas. And what I'm seeing here is this skewing of the facts and the report that, the work that you have done, that the Oakland Institute has done, and that this conflating of U.S. policy as far as Nicaragua is concerned, U.S. foreign policy as far as Nicaragua is concerned. There's no distinction of the indigenous people. There's no distinction of the land grabbing. There's no drilling down on the real issues. It's just this major claim that the Oakland Institute has something against the Nicaraguan government. And that's the part that I'm not understanding. And if the Task Force for Americas is listening to this show right now, which I'm sure that they are, because they were expecting a phone call back from me, if you want to challenge this again, we can go forward. This isn't the first organization. The Oakland Institute is not the first organization that has been attacked by the so-called group called the Task Force for the Americas. I recommend that you take the initiative to look at what the Oakland Institute has done and other organizations and other media outlets like PBS have done to uncover the real issue of land grabbing, not U.S. foreign policy towards Nicaragua as a whole, but the land grabbing by these transnational corporations in Nicaragua against the indigenous people and the Afro-descendants of Nicaragua. That is what needs to happen right now. Anwar, is there anything else that you would like to add just to round this out?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
There's also been criticism of the name of the report, Nicaragua's Failed Revolution. Mm. And I wanted to explain why we decided to call it that. Because if you look at the aspirations behind that revolution, mm-hmm. and you today see unfettered capitalism, the multinational corporations from Canada and UK and elsewhere mm-hmm. taking over the resources of Nicaragua, it is once again the repeat of what had happened under Somoza. This is not about building an economy from the bottom up for the people of Nicaragua. Mm-hmm. This is really about the elites, the political and economic elites, making deals and working together with foreign corporations to the detriment of the country's people, country's citizens, country's indigenous, as well as its environment. So that's why we decided to call it the Failed Revolution, because what you see is unfettered capitalism, capitalist policies, kowtowing to the policies of the World Bank, and working together with foreign multinational corporations. I'm quite sure that the task force of America and those progressives who once decided to join that revolution, that revolution failed. There is a need for a different kind of revolution, which puts the people of Nicaragua and its environment first, rather than putting corporate profits and putting Ortega family and it getting richer at the expense of the others first.
Very well put. I have one more question for you, Ms. Honorable Mittal. Why do you think they're going after organizations and independent media outlets that are lifting the veil of what is really happening to the indigenous and Afro descendants of Nicaragua? Why would they do that? What would be in it for them?
You know, I have no idea. I think these are well-meaning people who have spent many years. I could name them. However, one of the people, John Perry, who has been pushing this and working with this handful of other people and criticizing any kind of truth-telling by any organization, appears to be very, very close to the Ortega administration. There was a story just after 2018 when the protests were put down so violently that there was a statement made by a young student that was given by her after a lot of threat, intimidation, and torture. And he was responsible for putting out that statement to debunk that there are actual protests in the country, to debunk that the students are rising, and did not even use his own name and made a false identity. So one of the allegations that I've heard is that the people behind this are actually very close and in sync with the current government. And rather than see the truth, they perhaps benefit from it. At the Institute, we have not researched that. We have focused on the research that was asked for by the impacted communities, people who are seeing their livelihoods and lives destroyed, who face violence and threats and intimidation, who cannot go to their farms anymore, whose villages have been burned down. So this is where our focus is. And I hope with this program that those who are criticizing our work, making allegations about our work of being, you know, a US hit job or a NED hit job or a USAID hit job, they're obviously unfamiliar with the work of the Oakland Institute. And I would encourage them again to go find out who we are, the basis of our research, and if they genuinely care about Nicaragua, that they would work with the government of President Ortega to fix the problems, well-being of all Nicaraguans means well-being of indigenous and Afro-descendant communities as well, and respect for national legislation. That's what the communities are asking for. These people have not just called Institute names. They allege, you know, regional human rights mechanisms, international human rights mechanisms. They're all in the pockets of United States. I mean, this is a kind of paranoia and craziness, which unfortunately gives a bad name to progressives.
Understood. And again, folks, this is a Rude Awakening. It is a climate emergency show. That's how this conversation initially started, to have a discussion about what is happening as far as land grabbing by transnational corporations, the mining, the deforestation, and the impact on the environment in Nicaragua and elsewhere around the world. That is what this show is about. So to have to go back and to clear the air in regards to these this political slander that the Oakland Institute has had to deal with, that I'm dealing with now, having to deal with it on the air, is an unfortunate waste of time. But unfortunately, we do have to go down that road. So let's consider the air cleared. Anamata Mitchell, Executive Director for the Oakland Institute. Let's say thank you once again for taking the time out of your busy schedule to speak with us and to set the record straight. So we appreciate you taking the time. Thank you so much.
My appreciation to you, Sabrina. Thank you so much.
And that does it for another edition of A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. A big thank you to my guests, the good people over at the Green News Report, Gary Hughes and Anuradha Mittal, for taking the time. Man of Steel, Rod Aquila's on the controls. I'll be back next week, same time, same place. Stay tuned for the best Friday lineup on radio. Coming up next, a rebroadcast of Democracy Now! And of course, people, let's all remember to embrace each other as we embrace the mother of us all. Thank you for listening.
Don't trade it for peanuts. Donate your old car to KPFA and get the full tax write-off. Vehicle donations are a win-win for everyone. They're the perfect way to support KPFA. Put your unwanted car, boat, motorhome, or truck to good use. It's easier than selling it, and you'll get a tax receipt for your records. Donating your vehicle to KPFA is really easy, and it only takes 3 steps.
1.
Have your VIN number and the title to your car handy. Call the Car Donation Center at 877-411-3662 or fill out the Donate Now form online at kpfa.org to schedule a convenient time to pick up your vehicle.
3.
Give the tow truck driver your signed title and, of course, the keys. And that's it. When your vehicle sells, you'll receive a thank you letter and an IRS tax form 1098. Thank you for supporting community-powered KPFA.
This is Alice Walker. In these difficult times, I can't imagine living in a world without KPFA. Please donate what you can today.
Hi, this is Jeff Chang. For years, KPFA has been a beacon for all of us in times of political darkness and lack of hope. Let's stand with KPFA now. Please donate what you can today.
Hi, folks. This is Rebecca Gordon. We're living through some pretty hard times these days, and I can't imagine doing it without KPFA. Please donate whatever you can today. Thank you.
Donate today at kpfa.org.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.